Hi everyone, it's Dave here. Today I'm in the village of Ardley in Hertfordshire. It's quite a pretty village. We're going to take a walk around the village and show you a few things. And then afterwards we're going to take a walk to another village and I'm going to tell you a story about a terrible event that happened back in the 19th century. Firstly though, let's take a look around the village. Right, we're setting off. Got a fairly long walk ahead of us. I think the weather forecast is cloudy with a bit of sunshine here and there. As long as it don't rain. Back in the 1500s, a man by the name of Charles Chauncey was born here in this village. He emigrated to America in the 1600s. And eventually became president of Harvard College in Massachusetts until he died in 1671. Plotted my route on Google Earth. We're going to take a walk along the lane for a bit, then we're going to cut across country, go down an old disused Roman road towards the village I'm heading to. I want to look at a couple of curiosities on the way. Could be interesting. Coming up to a place called Moor Green, somewhere here. I'm going to take a footpath off. We're just coming up to where I need to turn off now. Footpath sign here. Yep, to Honey Lane. Back lane. Back lane's the one I want, the old Roman road. Thank you. Oh wow, look at the bluebells. Oh, fabulous. Wow. Wow, those bluebells were fantastic. Oh, I love this time of year. Everything's coming back to life. Brilliant. This old trackway here was built originally around about the 1st century AD by the Romans. It was originally a Roman road and it ran from the Roman settlement at Braffing, which is a few miles in that direction, onwards for about 10 or 15 miles to the town of Baldock in North Hertfordshire in that direction. Now it's just a trackway. Seems a shame really. Just taking a diversion off the old Roman road to have a look at something round here. I found this on Google Earth. Yeah, we come up off this trackway and there's this house, or there's I think it's two houses. I mean, what the heck are two houses doing right out here in the middle of nowhere, on the edge of a field? I mean, there's no roads here, there's just this dirt track, well, footpath. I mean, what's it doing here? I mean, it's probably been here quite a while, but I found this on Google Earth. I thought it was a bit weird. It's in a bit of a precarious state though, so I ain't gonna get too close, and the brickwork's crumbling, but what the hell was it doing right out here in the middle of nowhere? Oh well, another mystery. Right, let's get back on the Roman road and carry on. Glad the sun's come out at last anyway. Whew. I've done about 5 miles. I think I've got about another 3 to go. Not bad, not bad. Have a nice cup of tea when I get there. Got a nice tea shop. I think it's just a couple of hundred yards along this trackway and then we should come onto a country lane, and then we're at the second place I want to show you. Oh, right, finally made it. Oh. Right, now then, which way? Ah, that way. This cottage here is of historical and national importance, apparently. This beautiful cottage here, which is probably about half a mile outside of the village of Westmill, is called Button Snap, and it was owned by the 18th century poet and essayist Charles Lamb. last leg of the journey. Bottom of this footpath and we're there. Oh, we finally made it. I've come to the village of Westmill in Hertfordshire, and it's situated on Ermine Street, about a mile south of the small market town of Buntingford. Westmill's actually one of the prettiest villages in Hertfordshire. Oh God, I'm looking forward to this, I tell you. Oh God, nectar. The village of Westmill, owing to its old world charm and character, is often used as a backdrop for films and television series. In fact, this tea shop was actually used in the television series Foyle's War, an old detective series set during World War II. Like many village stories though, they either begin or end in the churchyard. Back in the year 1800, a highwayman sat in wait on Ermine Street, which is just a couple of hundred yards along the lane there. When a horse and carriage turned up, he did the usual, stand and deliver. Only somebody leaned out of the carriage window and shot him dead. His body was brought down here into the village, and he was buried in an unmarked grave somewhere in this churchyard. Strangely enough, a few days later, a very well-dressed and well-spoken woman arrived in the village and started making inquiries about the highwayman. When she was told that he'd been buried here in the churchyard, she asked for him to be exhumed. The permission was denied, and historians believe that it may have been his wife or his mother, and that he came from a well-to-do family that had fallen on hard times, so he decided to take up a life of crime to make up his funds. Strange story. Wonder where they buried him. This is the grave of leading stoker Bertie Pegram. Bertie was one of 900 sailors who were due to join a ship during the First World War, and they were transitioning through HMS Pembroke in Chatham in Kent. But owing to the fact that the ship had been sunk up at Scarpa Flow, they were ordered to stay at the barracks. And due to the fact the huge number of men there, they didn't have enough accommodation for them all. So they were temporarily billeted in the drill hall at HMS Pembroke. And on the night of the 3rd of September 1917, a German Gotha bomber came over and dropped a bomb straight through the roof of the drill hall. 130 men died. Bertie died the following day of his wounds. But somewhere else in this churchyard lies the unmarked grave of a little girl by the name of Lucy Game. Now, Lucy was born in 1844, and she was barely 4.5 years old when she was killed in the most horrific of circumstances. Now, Lucy was one of six children born to a William and Elizabeth Game. Her father, William, was a gamekeeper on the estate adjoining the village. On Thursday, the 24th of August, 1848, whilst the father was out helping with the harvest, Elizabeth Game had to leave some of the children alone unattended at the house. While she went out to help with the harvest, she went out to do what was called gleaning, which is where after the harvest, they go around picking up any surplus grain that's left over in the fields. While she was away, Lucy was playing in the garden. But at some point, she entered the house through the back door, which goes into the kitchen. And as she stood in the doorway, somebody pointed a shotgun at her and blew her head apart. Now, around 6:15 that evening, Elizabeth Game returned home from the fields. As she approached the cottage, she saw her son William and two other younger children standing in the lane near the cottage. Noticing that Lucy wasn't with them, she asked her son William, "Where's Lucy?" William rather chillingly replied, "She lies dead in the house." Not believing what she's hearing, Elizabeth Game ran into the house to be met by the most appalling scene. To find a little daughter laying dead on the kitchen floor with her head blown apart. News of this tragedy spread rapidly, and pretty soon a local police inspector by the name of Bryant was on the scene pretty quickly. He began examining the crime scene and interviewing witnesses. Now, the first person he interviewed was Lucy's older brother, William. William told him that he'd been out playing, and when he came home, he found Lucy dead on the floor. But other witnesses contradicted this statement. They say they saw William loitering outside the cottage at the time of the shooting. Now, Inspector Bryant went back to William and asked him again. This time, William came up with a different story. He told the inspector that he'd seen a man walking past the cottage muttering to himself, and then he'd heard a gunshot. Further inquiries drew a blank. Inspector Bryant couldn't find anybody of that description in the village. So he went back to William and asked him again. This time, William gave a chilling confession. He told the inspector that when Lucy came and stood in the kitchen doorway, he told her that he was going out to play with friends. Lucy said she wanted to go with him. William said, "No, you can't." Lucy said, "Yes, but I want to." William said, "No, you can't." And of course, an argument ensued. William went to his father's bedroom and got his father's loaded shotgun, which he always kept in the bedroom. He came back to the kitchen, pointed the shotgun at Lucy's head, and pulled the trigger. Now, William and his brothers and sisters had always been expressly forbidden from going anywhere near that shotgun. So William's confession basically went that he told the inspector that he'd gone out into the yard and got a billhook, which is like a chopper, and he attacked Lucy with the chopper, striking her over the head. And then he got a stick and started hitting her with a stick. But the autopsy contradicted this. During the autopsy, they found lots of shotgun pellets in Lucy's brain. And it turns out that William had attempted to disguise the shotgun wound by going and getting the billhook and hacking away at Lucy's body. He was more afraid of his father's reaction when his father found out that he'd been near his gun, rather than the fact that he'd just killed his little sister. But Inspector Bryant now had his killer. The inquest into the murder took place here, in the village pub, The Sword in Hand. At the inquest, which was held in the local pub a few days later, Inspector Bryant presented the coroner and the coroner's jury with his evidence, as well as William's confession. After an hour and a half of deliberation, the coroner's jury decided that William must go to trial for willful murder. William was arrested and remanded in custody in Hertford Prison until his case could come before the next Petty Assizes. 6 months later, on February the 29th, 1849, Williams was one of many cases that were presented at the Petty Assizes. A grand jury of 23 men were selected, and out of that 12 men were specially selected to review all of the cases that were being presented before the court that day. It was their job to review each case and the evidence that was presented by the prosecution, and they had to decide which cases were to go forward for trial and which were to be rejected. When William's case came up, the jury were told that if they decide William must go to trial, the court will only accept a verdict of either accidental death or murder. The court will not accept a verdict of manslaughter, owing to the fact that William had confessed to deliberately putting a gun to his little sister's head. It had to be either accidental death or willful murder. But the jury were also told, while they were deliberating, that they also had to decide whether William manifested the ability to know right from wrong, or whether he was a complete ignoramus and didn't know what he was doing. William was actually brought before the courts whilst this proceeding was going on. The jury eventually decided that William was a complete ignoramus and didn't know right from wrong. So the proceedings against him were dropped, and William was free to go home. Now clearly the jury's decision must have been a huge relief for William and his family, but it must have also been a bigger relief for the courts. If William had gone forward to face trial for willful murder and been found guilty, it would have put the courts in quite a difficult predicament. After all, how on earth were they supposed to punish a murderer who was only 8 years of age? It's difficult trying to imagine what kind of a sentence the courts might have meted out to William if he had gone on to face trial and been found guilty of murder. You've got to remember, this is the Dickensian period. The age of criminal responsibility was 7 years old. William was 8 and therefore criminally responsible. And after all, the courts had no scruples about locking him up in prison on remand for 6 months. So it's more likely, if William had been found guilty of murder, he would most likely have had a life sentence imposed on him. But it's also possible that he could have had a deferred death sentence, staying in prison until he became a teenager, and then going to the gallows. You know, it was rare they hung children back in the 1800s, but it's not unheard of. I do know of a young teenage girl who was hanged here in Hertfordshire some years before that. But luckily for William, they decided he was an ignoramus and threw his case out. Now, It's difficult to imagine what life must have been like in the game household in the weeks and months following this terrible event. You know, how do you relate to one of your own children knowing that they could do something so dreadful to one of their other children? There are some reports that William's mother went insane, but I haven't seen any evidence of that. Move forward 2 or 3 years to 1851, and the census shows that William, who's then 11, he's a schoolboy and he's still at home with his mother and father. His father is still a gamekeeper. It looks on the face of it as if life is just going on in the game household. But move forward 10 years to 1861 and the census shows a very different story. William's father, whose name is also William, is living alone at the cottage with one of his daughters. His status is that of a widower. William's mother, Elizabeth, died in 1858 of tuberculosis. And of course, William at this stage now, he's 21 and he's not on the scene. In fact, I tracked him down. He's now living in a village called Easington in East Yorkshire. Where he states his occupation as a jet miner. And I can only conclude from that memories of this terrible event stayed in the minds of everybody in the village and surrounding villages. William must have been shunned everywhere he went. He was obviously not a very popular person. After what he did to his little sister, and I can only conclude that he just felt there was no life for him here in the village. So he didn't just leave the village, he left the county and moved hundreds of miles north. After 1861, I don't know where he is. I can't find any trace of him, so I don't know what's happened to him. But, you know, it's such a shocking story for such a pretty village. Anyway, now the hard part. I've got to walk all the way back to Ardley. 8 miles. And it's getting dark. You know, it's a sad fact that as the older generations in the villages die off, the history of the village suffers. The old stories die away with them. These people are replaced by people who come in from outside the area. They move from the towns and the cities. They've got no connections to the village and they don't know anything about the history of the village that they live in. Everybody I've spoken to in this village know nothing about this story, which I think is pretty sad. I only came across this story in the county archives in Hertfordshire while I was researching my family history. My 4x great-grandfather lived here in the village at the time of the incident, and he was married to a lady called Sarah Game, who was one of William's father's cousins. And it's just one of many terrible stories that I've uncovered in my family history.